We welcome all the students, faculties, and working class professionals to this webinar on cloud and containers, which is organized and hosted by IPSR Solutions Limited. Before we get into this sessions for today, a few housekeeping rules. Please note that your mic and video will be switched off during the presentations. If you have any questions, you can post them in the chat window or unmute yourself and ask the questions to the presenter after the sessions are over, and there will be a Q&A section where you can actually ask the questions. Okay, so during the presentations, the mic will be muted off. So please, if you have any questions, you can post them in the chat window. All right, and during the questions Q&A section, you can actually unmute yourself and ask the questions. Okay. Now, before we get into sessions, also we would like to say something about IPSR Solutions Limited. IPSR is actually a team led by academicians and entrepreneurs. IPSR is a public limited IT company with 20 plus years of expertise in software product development, training, placement, and digital marketing services. During the last two decades, IPSR has also worked with 250 academic organizations, including universities, autonomous colleges, and both technical and non-technical institutions. The training division of IPSR conducts faculty development training programs, seminars, workshops, value-added certification courses, finishing school programs, corporate training, job-oriented training in education, IT, and IT-enabled services domain as well. IPSR was a training partner for the Technical Education Quality Improvement Program, TechIP, a World Bank assisted project executed in government engineering colleges by the Indian Ministry of HRD. IPSR is the world's leading Red Hat training and certification partner with 37 national and international awards and has produced the highest number of Red Hat professionals in the world. So far, IPSR has trained candidates from over 50 plus countries. IPSR's IT services division is a pioneer in development of academic solution products, incorporating new technologies of artificial intelligence, data analytics, and machine learning. IPSR also has specialized services and solutions for the education sector, ranging from simple websites to complex software applications that help to manage academic and operational activities like question paper generation, campus automation, accreditation processes like NAC, NBA, etc., and also OBE, that's outcome-based education. IPSR's placement division has over 1,500 placement type companies and conducts recruitment on all dates. Now we will move on to the first session. The first session for today. Could you please keep all your mics muted? Moderators, please take care of those, please. Right. Okay, the first session for today will be from Mr. Srinivas Prasad, who is an academic consultant and corporate trainer. He will be doing a presentation on this topic, that is Introduction to Cloud, AWS and Azure, and its career opportunities. A few things about Mr. Srinivas Prasad. Mr. Srinivas is a highly accomplished professional with over 20 plus years of hands-on experience in planning, designing, and implementation of cloud, cybersecurity, data center, big data, blockchain, and IoT projects. He has a high, rich IT experience, having served as solutions architect, project manager, technical consultant, and IT manager with Accenture, IBM, Wipro, Excel, and iGate. He has also domain expertise in niche areas like cybersecurity, IoT, big data, cloud computing, data center engineering, etc. Presently, apart from delivering training for universities, institutions, public sector, and corporate on IMS cloud, information security, cybersecurity, etc., he also holds the coveted positions of being an advisor to reputed organizations like VTU, that's Visveshwara Technological University, Veltech, Veltech, Dr. RR and Dr. SR Technical University, NASCOM, National Association of Software and Services, engineering colleges across different geographical areas, and Marine Group of Institutions, Kerala, wherein he has been instrumental in defining and executing professional development programs and bridging the gap between industry and academia by transforming the students into industry-capable workforce and promoting R&D initiatives. That's a brief description about Mr. Srinivas Prasad. Now I'm handing over the session to Mr. Srinivas. So,
yeah,
over to you.
Thank you, Mr. Susan. Yeah. Good morning, everybody. So, my name is Srinivas Prasad. I'm from Bangalore. So, the objective of the session already explained by Mr. Jayman. So mainly we are going to discuss on what is cloud, what are the career opportunities in cloud, and exactly what you need to learn to become a cloud professional. Okay. Then, what are the prerequisites required to get into any kind of cloud program, training program? Fine. I think in this, the total group which is participating today might contain the heterogeneous environment. I think some freshers would be there who are looking for the job. Already employees would be there. Who are looking for the better career. Okay. So freshers who are seeking, we can call it a job seeker. And for the employees, again, there are two categories of employees who are doing, who are in small jobs. Other category, already they are in high-end job. There might be two different categories also. But for all this, is it required to acquire the knowledge in the cloud? Yes. For freshers, because of the competition in the market and because of the rapid changes in the technologies, there is a demand, still there is a demand for the niche skills, a specific advanced or latest skills, we can say. Okay. So unless or until they focus on those niche skills or the skills which are in more demand by the industry, it is very difficult for them to get a job in the current scenario. Okay. So in the current scenario, you know that the profit margins of companies becoming very low. Could be TCS, could be IBM, could be Microsoft or whatever it may be. Because of the unhealthy competition, their profit is coming down. So when the profit comes down, obviously they will try to cut down the cost. Means, in another way, how it affects the recruitment practice in the sense. So before this particular crisis, they used to recruit the people and put them on the bench. Everybody knows what's meant by bench. There will be no work for them. But they anticipate if any project comes, they will be shifted into that particular project. But no company is maintaining that kind of bench nowadays. So whenever the project comes, based on that particular project, they are recruiting the people. Now the issue is, for example, a company called, for example, take Capgemini company. Let us assume that next month they are going to get a project. So after getting the project within 1 month, they need to get into the execution of that particular project. Then hardly how many days they are left for them. Within 30 days, they have to recruit the candidates. That is the scenario now. But after recruiting the candidates, do they have time to train them? Absolutely no, because from the day one, they have to participate in the project. So training by the company is no more possible in the current scenario. That's the reason they're expecting to train the candidates. In the sense, the candidates should be efficient enough to handle the project. Efficient enough means they should be well versed with that particular technology, troubleshooting, customer handling, and other things. Okay, that's the challenge. That's the reason. Even though jobs are there, right skilled candidates are not available. Okay, candidates are coming. They tell that I know AWS, I know Python, I know Java. They admit like that. But when they face interview, they are asking all real-time questions nowadays, not theory, like what is OOPS concept, what is this particular thing, what is cloud, what is private cloud, what is public cloud. Nobody is asking like that. Straight away, they are jumping into the real-time issues because you have to handle those kind of things. There, the big gap is coming. The person who downloads the video from the Udemy and gone through feels that I know the technology. The other person who joins in some institute, undergone the training, also will be under the impression that I know the technology. Now the limitations. In Udemy videos, you get the orientation, the overview, and some kind of practical experience. But it won't map to the real-time scenarios in the industry which you are going to face when you acquire the job in the industry. So in the institute, obviously the trainers might be having a little experience in the industry or might not be. So whatever they know, you will get the knowledge on that. But again, mapping to the real-time scenario is absolutely missing there. So that is the reason. Even though some of you or all of you are equipped with some skill set that is not sufficient to crack the interview, right? So that is one big challenge. For employees also, now what happens is the sustainability has become a very big issue. Sustainability in the sense, because of the influence of the new technologies, what's happening is, if the candidate is well versed with some technology, let's suppose that the employee is well versed with networking and well versed with Python. But if they don't get the project related to the networking or related to the Python, if they get related to the artificial intelligence, then they will expect that these people, if they are fit into this AI, they can continue, or else they have to quit. Okay, that's the scenario now. even the person who is having 25 years of experience also have been asked to quit in the Wipro company last week. So they are not considering the experience, they are considering the skill set. What kind of skill you have, technical skill? Are you fit enough to handle the new project or the new environment? Okay. So in this situation, you have to make your mind in such a way that whatever you are going to learn, whatever the technology, whatever it might be, it should map you to crack the interview. That's the main important, that's the objective, right? That's the reason you are spending your money and time to learn the thing. Otherwise, there's no point doing it. Okay? That's the very much important. In this context, if you take the industry scenario, because I worked for many MNCs, like I worked for HP, I worked for IBM, I worked for iGate, I worked for IBM. So the thing is, since I am having the good connectivity with the industry, I used to get the information. So what kind of skills are having in good demand right now? Right now, the current scenario is very good demand is there for cloud, followed by security. Security, followed by the data science. Then full stack, then IoT, Internet of Things, then AI. This is the current scenario right now. Right now. Because cloud is standing on the top, actually, when it comes to the recruitment and the numbers, followed by the security, followed by the data science. But in future means within 6 months or 1 year, along with this, these two are going to play a vital role, artificial intelligence and IoT, because majority of the companies are under the proof of concept, POC level. Now the implementation is not going or hectically, but once the POC part is over, they will jump into that, okay? Followed by another fantastic technology called blockchain. These are all the technologies which are going to rule the world for at least coming a decade. There is no doubt about it. So every service, every sector, every domain, it could be healthcare, it could be manufacturing, it could be pharma, logistics, government services, financial, everything will be incorporated with all these technologies. There is no other way. Okay. But then again, there are so many wrong perceptions are there related to each and every technology among the public. For example, today's topic is cloud. First of all, what is cloud? Okay, and why we need cloud? What to learn for the cloud? And which platform is best? Example, AWS is there, Azure is there. Which one we need to learn, which is having the more demand and why? So what is the scope in terms of jobs? And what is the next step, what I have to learn after cloud? Okay, So you should have the clarity on all these particular aspects. Okay. Fine. We go through on all this. First of all, as I already told you, give me a second. Different perspectives are there. So normally I used to give the corporate trainings for the corporates and universities also. Whenever I ask the question, what is cloud? Many people give the same answer like storing the data. It's not like storing the data. Cloud is not confined to only data storage. It's beyond, much beyond. Okay. So, but then how you can define the cloud? The fundamental definition of the cloud, you have to understand in a proper manner. It provides on-demand service. That is nothing but cloud. Here, the service could be an OS. You require an operating system. You require a computer. You require an application. You want a firewall. Okay. Just I'm citing some examples. Or you want a game. You want some ERP. Or you want some analytics platform. So whatever the service you want a website. Whatever the service you want, the cloud should be in a position to provide you on demand. On demand means whenever you want. You may want right now, or else from 2 p.m. to 3 p.m. today, or the total year, or one day. So, irrespective of the time zone. And you may be in USA, you may be in India, irrespective of the location. Okay. So somebody should be in a position to provide the service to you. That is the definition of the cloud. Second wrong perception is most of the people feels that cloud means it will be in the internet only. Not required. If you talk about the private cloud, no need of internet. Within your land, within your organization also, you can establish that, you can share the resources. So internet intervention in the cloud is not must, is not mandated. Okay. So please don't be under impression that cloud means it is always we require an internet. That depends on the modem which we are going to deploy. If it is a public cloud, obviously we need an internet, but if it is in a hybrid cloud or private cloud, might be or might not be. Okay, that's the thing. Second, okay, so just for the formality's sake, I have put this slides. Again, if you go through the slides, you will also get bored. Just I want to show you some kind of demo. Today, what I'm planning is let us host some small web page in the cloud and we'll try to access. Okay, but before getting into that, let us finish all this. The features are fundamentally, why industry is going for cloud? That also you have to understand. Why industry? Sorry, adopting. Yeah. See, for example, so far. This is an office. This is some manufacturing company. For example, Toyota. Toyota manufacturing company is in Bangalore. Okay. obviously they have to maintain the very big servers which are run with the applications, and they have to maintain the connectivity devices like routers, like firewall, and they have to install some applications. Servers means on top of that operating system is required, applications are required, then antivirus is required. And to maintain this all the hardware, they have to provide the sophisticated air conditioning system which has to run for 24 hours. Okay. Then monitoring is required, because whether the servers are up or running or down, somebody has to monitor. And the backup need to taken care by the company, because if some crucial data is there every day, you have to take backup. Okay. So like this, we are managing. What are the challenges? You have to allocate the space for that, which is very costly. Especially, for example, if you take the city, cosmopolitan city like Bangalore, every square feet is very costly. So that much of space you have to take. Second, you have to buy the hardware. If you buy the hardware, the maintenance is a very big issue. You can't expect that 365 days it will smoothly run, right? Some problems will come. Okay. Then again, you have to buy the software. You have to invest a huge amount of money for all these things. Plus maintenance. You have to recruit some engineers to maintain all these things. Okay. So apart from that, air condition, unnecessary expenditure leads to global warming. Okay. So all these constraints are there. Apart from that, very important other constraints are availability. Availability in the sense is the access to these servers can be ensured 365 days, 24 hours. What do you say? Is it ensured? Is it guaranteed that you will have the availability of that resource? If because of some torrential rains, if the flood comes, the entire Toyota premises will be under the water, then how you can reach? Or else, so the biggest power failure or something happens, fire accident happens for this entire infrastructure, is it possible to access the services? So you can't give the guarantee. You can't give the guarantee. So availability, you have to keep this particular thing in the mind. Availability is the major, major concern. Then one more major concern is flexibility. Flexibility in the sense, for example, this server is having 128 GB RAM. They have purchased. But all of a sudden, they got an application. They want to install the application immediately, but it expects 256 GB RAM to run that application. Then is it flexible? Can you change the 128 GB RAM to 256 within seconds or minutes? Not at all possible. Not at all possible. So you have to replace the RAM. For that, you have to shut down. Again, you have to reboot the system server. You require the downtime. You require the time. You require the money. So many factors are there. Again, after few days, you don't want 256. You are removing that, uninstalling that application. The job is get done. Then again, 64 GB RAM is sufficient. Then what you do? Already you bought 256. Waste. Means flexibility. Whenever you want, you can expand. Whenever you want, you can downgrade. Upgrade and downgrade, we call it as flexibility. That's not possible in the physical environment. Okay. The other important thing is accessibility. Accessibility in the sense, wherever you are, irrespective of the geographical location, you should be in a position to access that. That's not that much easy in the physical IT infrastructure. So considering this all disadvantages with the IT, physical IT infrastructure, and considering the advantages of cloud, that's the reason every industry, 85% of the industries across the globe are shifting towards the cloud. Again, please don't under the impression that industry means only IT companies are moving the cloud. Not only IT companies. It could be a Pepsi company. It could be a Toyota. It could be a Biocom. Manufacturing, pharma, services, government, public, private, every sector, irrespective of their operations, shifting towards. Okay, except the banks. They're not moving into the public cloud because they have some constraints. They have to follow certain standards and compliances. So except the financial domain, every other domain is shifting towards cloud. Now the financial domain also moving to the cloud, but not to the public cloud. It is hybrid cloud. Hybrid means it's the combination of the private and public. So the bottom line is 100% industry is shifting towards cloud. That's the reason there is a lot of opportunities, job opportunities have been created in the market. People need, because to migrate, so what kind of activities you will have, what kind of skill set they're expecting. So people who are well versed with migration, it's a very big activity. So you have to understand the current IT environment. You have to plan the virtual environment. Cloud is nothing but virtual. It's not a physical, it's a virtual. Okay. Then you have to plan the budget according to that. Cost also matters. Then you can migrate. Then after that, maintenance. After migrating your web server or database server or applications or everything into the cloud, somebody has to maintain from your end. Cloud is the enabler, they provide that. But maintenance, configuration, day-to-day activities, you have to take care. So in this vertical also, a lot of opportunities are there. Again, one more thing is billing. Don't feel that it's some billing means it's a low-end job, it's a very high-end job. Billing in the sense, for example, if the customer approaches you to give the solution based on the different factors, considering the technical and his budgetary constraints, you have to give the proper plan, estimation to the customer, which is the best plan. It's not a simple task. Like that. Then security. So after implementing the cloud, somebody has to take care about the security. Like that, different job roles, different types of teams will be available inside the company. Okay. So basically, the underlying technology is, say for example, this is your laptop. Means you are the user, you are the end user. And you are running with Windows 10 operating system. for your lab. Now, you want to publish your website. You are running a small company. You want to publish your website. That's the task. If the cloud is not there, there are two different ways. You can buy a server, put it in your office. Let's call it as web server. Put it in our office. Then design that particular website with the help of others. Put the website here. Then buy a public IP. Configure that public IP to this. Then take the internet connection. This should be connected to the internet. So any users from outside can access this. But for all this, how much time, how much cost you have to invest? See, for server hardware, you have to buy. For web hosting, for website designing, you have to spend. For that static IP, you have to pay. For internet connection, and apart from that, one administrator is required because somebody has to take care, now you have to pay the salary for it. This is one way. Or else you take the service from the GoDaddy, third party. You can take the service from the GoDaddy, you can host there, but for that also you have to pay per annum this much storage and all. So before cloud, we are doing like, but it, now it's everything is very simple. The entire process is very simple. With low cost. Okay. So example, let us just within 10 minutes, I want to deploy a web page. So which can be accessed by anybody from anywhere. So for that, I'm going to do like this. Okay. So already I created a virtual machine, running with Windows Server in the cloud. This is AWS. Okay. So I'm going to connect. What's our objective? Our objective is I want to deploy a web page, simple web page, which can be accessed by the public. That's my objective. Let's see how much time it will take. So I'm not getting into the technical details because this is not the right platform, what I am doing. Just my intention is how we can use the cloud services. That's what I want to explain. So I am logging into the virtual machine, which I have created. It is prompting for the password. So I have configured Windows 2019 server operating system in the cloud. Now I'm entering into that, because to configure the website, obviously you require a server operating system. You can't host a website in the client operating system like in Windows 10, Windows 8, or in Linux also, 10.2OS, these kind of client operating systems, you require a server operating system. That's the reason I have done that. Okay, I'm entered into this. This is the virtual system which is running in the cloud. But I feel that as if it is running in my own laptop. Okay, now I need to deploy the web page. For that, first of all, I need to configure the web service, because this system has to act as the web server. For that, I need to configure the web service. To configure the web service, I need to install Internet Information Server, IIS, on top of the Windows. Okay, takes little time. Now my objective is I need to configure. So here I have to select the web server. And I am going to install it. So once it installs, this will become the web server. Then you can host the website on top of it. Means if you have designed that with the help of WordPress or something, even web designing is not a big issue nowadays, right? Without the knowledge in programming also, you can do that. Let's assume that you have some website with you. So I'm configuring the services, whatever I want. Fine. Now, I'll try to configure a small web page. I'll get into the C drive. In that, you have a file folder inetpub under www root. Here, you can create an HTML page. We open a text document. Okay. So that is hello world. This is my test web page. Okay. I'll put like this. This is my HTML document. This is my home page. Let's assume that. I am going to save this as index.html. Okay. It comes with this particular symbol. Now, I'm hosted a web page in this. But can I access? Let me check. To access that, I am copying the public IP of this. Okay. And I am using my browser. I am getting this. Okay. So I am in the chart. Any one of you can you try to access with this IP address from your mobile or from your laptop and let me know that are you able to access this Hello World page? Anyone please? Yes, Kishan Lal. Let's see to everyone. Okay. So fantastic. So how much time I have take to deploy that? Hardly 5 minutes. But imagine that if cloud is not there, if cloud is not there, how much time it will take? You know that the procedure, right? So that's the beauty of the cloud. Okay. So within a seconds, you can launch the services and you can access from anywhere. And you can take the backup. Yes, someone maybe says yes. It's minimum. It takes 3 days for the dedicated server. If you have the code, if you have that HTML pages, 10 HTML pages, just like that, you can implement into that. Okay. Now, the thing is, what you have to learn. There are prominent players are there, AWS, Azure, Google Cloud. So again, among these, they are very good in infrastructure as a service. These people are good in platform as a service. First of all, you need to understand the difference between the infrastructure as a service and platform as a service. Infrastructure means like for a simple understanding, infra. You want to launch a server with 50 GB hard disk, 32 GB RAM with Red Hat Linux. So this is infrastructure. If it could be a server, it could be a firewall, it could be that's what physically what you see that, but is infrastructure. If you want to deploy that, IaaS, AWS is preferred by the customers. But when it comes to the platform, platform in the sense you want to deploy an application in that, or you want to deploy some app in that, not in your own environment, some in the cloud. So you want to give the access, or you want to deploy the databases, or if you want to deploy the artificial intelligence solutions. So if you want to deploy your solutions on the cloud, majority of the people prefers Azure because it is supporting that kind of services better than AWS, and the discount is getting by Microsoft is also need to be considered. Cost is also need to be considered because, for example, if you take the scenario in India, majority of the industries, they are working on Microsoft platforms like .NET, MS Office, now this is MS Outlook, whatever it may be. So obviously they prefer Azure to migrate because that is compatible with the AWS also supports everything. But if you talk about the infrastructure, you want the robust, sophisticated hardware, the speed matters, then the people go for AWS. That depends. Again, that depends on your interest. Okay? Both are having good demand. Both are having their own importance. But to be frank with you, Azure is having an edge over AWS for the placement. Lot of opportunities are there in the market for Azure as of compare with the AWS. It does not, I am not underestimating AWS. AWS also in good demand, but comparatively, lot of opportunities are there for Azure. People are not available. When you compare with the AWS, little complicated. The interface, understanding the concept, little, okay? Because of that criticality issue, many people don't go for Azure, but having a fantastic demand in the market, okay? That's the situation. So when it comes to the content, already I told you, you can go to Udemy, you can download, you can join in any other institute. But I am again reiterating that real-time practices are important. Okay. Example, if I am opening the Azure content, which I prepared, it's a unique content because unique, why I am mentioning unique, just we have not copied from the Azure website. Because that won't serve the purpose. So the objective of this particular thing is Azure networking, network security groups, everything. For example, if you talk about the Azure firewall, I'll teach you what is firewall, how to configure. Apart from that, what are the real-time scenarios with the Azure firewall? That also I'm going to practically explain you. See, if you go through the Udemy videos also, you'll come to know that what is Azure firewall, where you have to click to deploy that. But in the real time, what are the issues you will encounter? That is more important. Like that, every topic is correlated with the, according to the real time only we are going to teach you, not just the concept, not just the theory. Okay. Like that, I cannot get into the details of each and every module because we have time constraint. This is a seminar, this is not a session actually. Okay, we are covering all the topics which are very much required to get the practical knowledge and to crack the internet. Okay, apart from that, with this knowledge, you can very easily clear the certification also. Clear the certification. Like that, we have created the syllabus from AWS also. In the same manner, every topic will be discussed and practiced with the real-time case study and troubleshooting also. Okay. So after getting the knowledge in the cloud, it's very important, not in the first phase. If you get the job, after that also, it's very important for you to upgrade with the DevOps. DevOps is nothing but the automation of the cloud. So in the industry, manually, we are not going to configure. Now I have shown you how manually launch the website. But in industry, with the help of the script, with the help of the automation tools, we'll do that. That we'll discuss on the DevOps. But it's a different track, actually, different track. But the fantastic combination in the career perspective is anything AWS plus DevOps, Azure plus DevOps, or AWS plus Azure plus DevOps. The third one is the excellent combination. The reason is, for example, if you take Infosys company, they are providing the cloud services. The client approaches, one client asks for the AWS, another client asks for the Azure. So we can't say, that's the reason they're expecting the person should know both. So if they want this, you can offer that. If they want that, you can configure that. But again, we have to consider your budget, your time, and other things also. So, but I'm explaining the industry scenario to you. Okay.